Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call the regular Plan Commission meeting of May 15th, 2017, to order. The first item on the agenda is roll call. Claire, could we, Gail, could we please have a roll call?
Yes. Doyle?
Here.
Jane?
Here.
Lal?
Here.
Ayer? I'm sorry, he's not here. Trapinski?
Here. We have a quorum. And the next item on the agenda is approval of the meeting of the minutes. These are the meetings of the minutes from February 13th. May I have a motion to approve them as written? Second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, the minutes of meeting are approved as written.
Marcia, pull the mic down.
Oh, thank you. Okay. The next item on the agenda is new business. We have Rock Sugar Incorporated at 2022 Spring Road. They're here for a special use permit for outdoor dining in an area adjacent to a restaurant. And then after that, we will follow with the Village of Oakbrook, further amendments for the zoning ordinance for parking structure regulations. That's section 13-12-4J. We're going to start with Rock Sugar Incorporated. May we have a representative come to the podium, please?
Marcia, can I just start out? Before we start, Moyen Syed, one of our new village trustees, he's the liaison to our Plan Commission. I think he might have been on the Plan Commission once upon a time.
Yes.
Marcia. And now he was on the village board once, and he loved it so much, he's back on it again. So he's our new liaison.
Moyen Welcome. All right. I'm sorry, Bob, did you have anything to add on this?
No, because if I say too much, then he won't have anything to say.
All right. Please.
Good evening. My name is Brian McKellar. I'm the Senior Vice President of Development for the Cheesecake Factory Incorporated. We're the owners of Rock Sugar, and we are here tonight to apply for a special use permit for a patio. This is a conceptual design that shows the Rock Sugar adjacent to the existing Cheesecake Factory on the property that was once a movie theater that we developed quite a few years ago. Rock Sugar is a upper level restaurant, higher than Cheesecake Factory. It takes reservations, is chef driven. We have our executive chef, Chef Mohan, who is a highly acclaimed chef of Southern Asian cuisine. He's originally from Singapore. This is our second location. The original location is near our founder's residence in Century City, California. So we have been developing this restaurant for almost 10 years. And this is the first time we've ventured into a new area. So we're very excited about this. And we hope, you know, we hope we're ready for the guests here in Oakbrook. So as part of the design, you can see the patio on the right-hand side, and that's what we're here for tonight. We consider patios to be an integral part of restaurants. Many people love that, especially on days like today, where the weather's great. So I'll take you through a little bit of the design. Here we're identifying the fact that where the current patio is shown was formerly just 9 parking spaces. So they all ran straight facing the building in a row. And this patio has displaced those. The outline of the building is shown there, and the patio area is highlighted in red. So what you're seeing in pink, pinkish color, is the existing Cheesecake Factory, the existing patio. And then in blue is the actual Rock Sugar restaurant. It is really independent in every way from the Cheesecake Factory. The area in green is an area that we have removed from the Cheesecake Factory that was currently used for offices and for some training. So that space is being totally removed and rebuilt as part of the Rock Sugar kitchen. There is a service area in the back corner that is being jointly used by both restaurants. You can see the patio on the side here. You can see that the entrance is located here. Hostess greeting, bar area, and then dining, and then an exposed kitchen in the back, and restrooms, and all the support activities for the kitchen. A little bigger view gives you a good idea. You can see the same entrance area, bar area, and then the full dining room. And the exposed kitchen on the end, along with the restrooms for guests. And then as you go beyond this point, it's back of house kitchen activities. Another view of the patio, the other directions. I think one of the main things we'll get into about the patio is the fact that it has bollards that are used as lighting supports, as well as to support a railing that is made out of glass. Oops, that runs, you can see the glass. So every other bollard is tall. That's a short one, then a tall one. And that's the ambient lighting that we have created for the patio. These bollards are there to ensure that no accidental, that nothing happens from a car that might lose control or have some kind of problem. So we built those into the actual railing, and that will really help ensure the safety of the guests. This is a more civil plan. It's showing some of the impact to the area. We have added some handicap spaces right here and some to-go spaces here, spaces that will be identified as to-go, and then a sidewalk across with a stop sign. So that'll be an easier area to cross to the entry into the restaurant. And this is just the existing Cheesecake Factory and patio. A little closer view makes it a little easier for guys that are as old as I am to read. So we can see the impact here is just restriping and identifying and clearly making a very visible walkway and the actual stop sign. This depicts how we're related to both employee and parking for valet. Our intention is to not add any additional valet area, just the fact that over on the left, there's a Cheesecake Factory existing valet area that we will direct people to if they would like to valet. There won't be a second valet here. So that should keep the traffic in better shape. So this indicates where we can park for employees and for valet. This is a depiction of the pipe bowlers that we're using to protect the people on the patio. You saw them in the previous rendering. These particular ones are located in the very front. They already exist for Cheesecake Factory and just would continue along. There is a pipe bollard inside this planning box. This is a depiction of the bollard. It's been engineered by our structural engineer to handle any impacts. It's not just a superficial, barely in the ground approach. It's a full 3 foot into the ground with a foundation and rebar, and should provide plenty of strength. This is a little more detail about it. They're located, again, all along this railing, and spaced every 4 feet? Every 4 feet. This is some of the products being used in the patio, chair, table, and sub-top. These are the lights that we are hanging across to give some ambience. Heaters, gas heaters to extend the evening and the season, as well as our custom umbrellas. The flooring is a, it's called Blue Danube limestone, and that's the main paving in the on the patio. This gives you an idea of what the materials are on the rock sugar facade. Vero plaster is a very special plaster we get from Italy, and it's smooth, but it has a texture to it, as you can see over here and here. One of the questions that came up is about music. Our company is obsessed about the quality of music, so I don't want you to misunderstand the number of speakers or the size of them. That is all about quality. It's not about volume. We're very sensitive because the original founder and CEO of Cheesecake Factory was a musician to begin with, so he can hear sounds that that are of the most minute level. So it's all about the quality of the sound. It's just background music. That's all it is. But we take it very seriously. He takes it so seriously that every single song that is played is personally chosen by him. You wouldn't think that of a guy who's CEO of such a big company, but that's how much we care about music. So they're located along the exterior facade. This is the actual speaker. Oops. So I'll go back. So those are the locations. I thought there was one view showing them. Maybe it's after. No. Okay. In the where the red dots are, that's where the speakers are actually located. Trying to be as inconspicuous as possible, but because of the quality demands, they are a little bigger. So at the end here, we have just an indication of the landscaping we intend to use, all just chosen for this area. So these are the products we expect to have. We're also very obsessed with the fact that when we open, our plants are fully grown and quite dense. I think that's the end of the presentation.
Thank you. I'd like to open the discussion to the plan commissioners. Do any of the plan commissioners have any questions or comments they want to make? Tom?
Just a simple comment. Your patio is south-facing, and the tree landscape that's included is actually rather short in height. I think even at full height, those particular trees are not very tall. Is there any consideration of perhaps using some kind of landscape that would provide more shade to the area, because a south-facing exposure in a day like tomorrow is going to be it's going to be extremely intense. It's just a comment. It's not I'm not expecting you. It's just a thought that you might want
to. I would personally agree, because I'm not exactly able to take the sun that well myself, but I think we can definitely do that. Make sure they're quite tall.
It's just a thought.
I thought the depiction was that they were quite tall. Maybe it's not showing quite as well as I would like, but it is our intention to make them quite tall. Sorry, there. I think those are in the neighborhood of 6 or 7 feet, wouldn't you say?
That offers no shade.
Yeah, and clearly they will.
Again, it's a comment. It's not a criticism. It's just a thought that you might want to consider. That's
okay.
Nothing further.
Okay, Dr. Lal.
Thank you very much. Very detailed presentation, and we appreciate your diligence. I just have a question. As I gather it, the patio is 70 by 7 times 16 by 8 feet. And seating arrangement is about, what, 64 people? Would you correct me, yes or no?
Sure. It's probably
so, are you worried about congestion there? Is that
No.
You are busy? So how many tables? You're talking about six per table or four?
Well,
depends, I guess.
It depends. It does depend. But there are several things that we know for a fact. We have 40 years of restaurant experience, so we are very diligent about pathway widths and separations. So we have that down to a science. Many of the tables are meant to be put together. So there are many examples where a party of 10 or 12 would have three tables put together. But just as equally, many times a four-seater is only, you know, only has two people at it. So we're very aware of the different options that the patio layout gives us. And we've really, I would actually say this is definitely on the small side. This is not on the big side of patios for us.
It's not a criticism. The concern that this community has a quite senior population, and people who have used a wheelchair or a motorized car, is there enough room for them to maneuver safely and store them while they're sitting on a chair, or possibly, if they can't sit on a chair, sitting on their wheelchair or motorized cart?
Oh, definitely. Absolutely, we've provided for that. The way certain tables are set up are for the handicapped. They have two legs that are separated properly so that it's very easy to go right up to. Our architect, Larry, is who's here, is diligent about making sure.
Well, thank you very much.
Sure.
With respect to that, we have building and fire codes that both the fire department and our development services staff will look at to make sure that this area is not over-occupied in terms of the occupancy load. One of the things that I think we'd want to add as a condition is that, you know, you mentioned that the tables can be moved around. We would want to make sure that at all times that there were clean and clear means of egress and exit from the property, so that if the fire department had to come there, people could easily move. So we may put that as a condition.
Sure, and it equally is just as important to be able to properly serve people to have those passageways and aisles.
Right. Okay, anyone else? Questions, comments on the plan commission?
I had a question.
Sure, Ken.
Does anybody else have music over there? Like the Cheesecake Factory currently?
The Cheesecake Factory has music.
Has outdoor music?
Yes. Just ambient music. It's not the kind of thing you're going to hear from any distance.
The reason I say that is that the music will face a hotel, and that would be my concern.
Yep.
Yeah, it's not at that level.
This type of thing came up when we did the Perry's and Old Town Poorhouse. I think the mall has covenants still over this property. I think there are tenant guidelines. I remember this was what Chuck Fleming told us, is that they actually have tenant requirements and guidelines that regulate sound. So they regulate all of their outdoor dining areas, even though it's not part of the mall itself. So I think when we reviewed those the last time, their requirements are more restrictive than ours. So I think we're in good shape.
Very good. Quiet.
Okay,
just one question. I think this is great. I think you covered in terms of the ballards you're putting in, but that's the area when we enter. The traffic is virtually a nightmare because it's only one-way stop sign and then the traffic. So my only concern is, and this patio is not, I mean, I don't know what the distance from that entrance where that one-way stop sign is, with people hanging out outside and think, it's very close to a very high traffic area right now. Is there been any thought given to that, or is that's not an issue? We looked into that?
It's really not an issue. If you look at the Cheesecake Patio, it's it's successful, and it's yeah. it's even more on the busier side.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. From a traffic perspective, that shouldn't be an issue.
No.
All right. Anybody in the audience have any questions or comments to make? In that case, can we have a motion? A motion? Can we have a motion? Tom, do you want to make?
And including suggestion of Mr. Kellyan, as long as that is included.
Right.
Okay. I think for approval.
Maintaining
all right.
Their aisle widths and
access. All right.
Do you want me to read the whole thing?
For the record.
Okay.
Please. Thank you.
No problem. Well, the Plan Commission Zoning Plan Commission is of the opinion that the applicant has satisfied the requirement for a special use of outdoor dining. A recommendation would be in order to approve this request, subject to the meeting the following condition. Number one, the development of outdoor dining areas shall be in substantial conformance with the plan as submitted and approved. Number two, the restaurant will be responsible for maintaining and clearing the outdoor area and shall comply with the applicable requirement of the DuPage County Health Department. Number three, the outdoor dining area will be operated in accordance with the following rules of operation. A, maximum seating capacity is 64% may be provided in the outdoor dining area. B, there will be no live entertainment in the outdoor dining area. Number four, comply with all other applicable rules and ordinance of the village in Oak Brook. Number five, the add the provision not standing the attached exhibit. The applicant shall meet all village ordinance requirements at the time of building permit application, except as specifically varied or waived. Does that include your comment?
And we can add, maybe as part of the, we have A, setting it at 64, B, no live entertainment. Maybe we could create a C that just says that.
Meet fire codes.
That they'll continue to meet all fire codes regarding aisle widths and egress and access.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much.
Okay.
Madam Chair, that's my motion.
All right, thank you. And Tom, you're seconding it? Okay, Gail, may we please have a voice vote, please? A roll call?
Doyle?
Yes.
Jane?
Yes.
Lal?
Yes.
Wilczek?
Yes.
Tropinski?
Yes. The motion is approved. Gail, what is the next step, please?
Okay, the next step is you'll be going before the Zoning Board of Appeals for public hearing on Tuesday, June 6th, 7 p.m. in this boardroom.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda for new business is the Village of Oak Brook at 1200 Oak Brook Road. As for a text amendment on the Zoning Ordinance Section 13-12-4-J regarding parking structure regulations. And Bob, I believe you're going to make a presentation.
I'll try. I'll go quick. At the present time, the way our village code is written, we allow, there are very large setbacks required for parking areas that abut streets. Some places we have 100 feet. Some places is even more than that. And then when there's some exceptions, usually they're allowed to only have 6 spaces in a required front yard. But the code is very silent to what happens if a parking area is not along a street and it's in a rear yard or side yard, especially those rear or side yards that abut residential areas. And let's take, we have a number of examples. Let's say up in Forest Glen, we have the Blistex Corporation. Where's the little light? Gail, your little light doesn't work.
That might be a red laser rather than the other one.
So up in the northeast corner of town, you have Blistex and a number of other businesses up there. They have parking within 10 feet of that property line. Along, let's see. So that's not working either.
It does. Oh. There we go.
Where's the light?
Right.
Oh, okay. Okay. Okay, well, yeah, I was up in the ceiling. That helps. So here's Woodside Estates in Forest Glen. You have parking lot within 10 feet. Here all along Commerce Drive, near where Marsha lives, Harger Road, you have parking that's within 10 feet of the property line, abutting Steeplechase. Over here at the where the Drake Hotel, you have parking lots at about 10 feet of York Woods. Over here, even with the mall, along 16th Street, even though you have some areas where the parking gets very, very close to the street. So what our goal was, and this was directed to us by our village board, was to look at creating some type of ordinance or some requirements that if somebody decides to build a parking deck, it's not treated the same as a parking lot, but it would be treated more similar to that of a principal structure. So example, if the parking deck were 20 feet high, our proposed language would basically say, okay, if you go up 20 feet, for every foot that you go up that you abut the residential area, you have to go back 2 feet. So you'd go back 40. Yeah. So it'd be 50 feet. Now, on the dais here in yellow and white,
yes.
Mr. Huffman, who's in the back of the room, he's the staff person for the Duchess Walk Company. He was happy enough to review what I had written, and I think he has added some words in yellow to help clarify. So I'm very much in favor with Bill's assistance here. And I would ask us that we would, if there is going to be a vote taken or discussion, that we focus in on the one page that was handed out. So the way it's written again, right now a parking deck. So let's take the Drake Hotel, right back up here behind the Drake Hotel. The buildings, the way the ordinance in the B4 says, the building has to be 100 feet from any residential area, but a parking lot can be within 10 feet. So today, if there were no code provision proposed, if someone could build a parking deck within 10 feet of that property line. And I think there probably would be some residents that would find that to be not a very attractive thing. So again, we're saying as if someone contemplates a parking structure, as it goes up, it moves further away. And at some point, once the structure raises about 45 feet, it now is going to be back to the 100-foot setback line,
right,
which that would be the rules then for the principal building. So we're trying to make it a little bit fairer for the residents that live in these areas. Again, we have not had a problem, but I think as Oak Brook redevelops, I think there's more and more opportunities for some of these conflicts. This is some language that our zoning consultant, Khan, is here. We will, as part of our overall zoning update, we would ask that this language also be included there. But there was a sense of urgency at our board, so they wanted us to look at it separately. So that's it really in a nutshell. So if you have any questions, we can answer any that you may have. Again, the goal is just that portion of the area that abuts a residential area that would be affected. So for instance, if the Duchess Walk group is up here and their main frontage is off of Windsor Road, the only place that they would be subjected to this provision, if it were adopted, is only that area of their property that would abut Woodside Estates or Forest Glen. And again, I'm not aware of them having any plans to do anything at this point, but they would be affected by this.
Hey, Bob. Today, it's mainly requirement is 10 feet. Is that
right now? Basically, it's 10 feet.
That's really what it is. The difference is the height and adjusting for the height. That's
and again, when you think of, think of that wall along the side of this side here behind you. I mean, that's only about a 20-foot wall. If that were 10 feet from a property line, that would be not very attractive, mm-hmm. and everybody would be calling the village and wanting to know how we allowed that to happen. So that's why we're trying to stay ahead of the game. I've talked to some developers. They said this is fair. You know, it could be massaged. It could be a different number, but this is a fair and a reasonable concept. So,
it makes a lot of sense, because as you raise the height, the lighting gets higher.
Yep.
So that's going to shine into people's yards.
And we still have in our code, there's other portions of this text that we're not changing, but it talks about the upper level lighting, that the poles be located in the middle. They have to be properly shielded. I think we learned a little bit with the recent mall development. So we, you know, I think there's protections there in place now.
Anybody else have any comments?
No, I appreciate the addition. That clarifies more.
Now, I know there's Barbara Lang, she lives in York Woods. She's here in the purple. She's here as a representative of York Woods, since they have the, you know, there's been lots of rumors about what is or what's not going to happen at the Drake Hotel. So she's here in case you want to ask her for her input.
Okay. After the plan commissioners get done, Tom, do you have any comments or anything? All right. Do you want to make any kind of statement and come to the podium? For the record, would you please state your name and address?
My name is Barbara Lang. I live at 58 Windsor in York Woods.
That would be about right in here, somewhere in here.
Yeah, at the intersection of Croydon and Windsor. I was concerned about the setback, but we're also concerned, again, about the noise and the light pollution. So even though this addresses the setback, I would assume that the architectural design of the parking structure would also have to be addressed and taken into consideration, because having the lights towards the residential area and a lot of openings towards the residential area, it would add, the noise would be reflected and the light would be reflected towards the houses. And even though the setback is 100 feet, if you go into the parking structures into Oak Brook Center and just walk through them, you can hear the cars go whizzing through, and the noise is substantial. And I'm sure that 100 feet back at night, that sound would just intensify. So I would hope that the architect would provide some consideration in their design. Also, the lighting, again, you somewhat addressed that, but I would hope with the design work, with the noise, the lighting would also be taken into consideration. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, if I could just respond to that. So about 15 years ago, we actually amended part of the code for parking structures, because back then we thought there were going to be a bunch of new ones, and there never were any built except for the one that was built in the mall. The ordinance says that a parking structure must have the exterior finish must be similar in character to that of the principal building. So, you know, the days of just doing precast, we wouldn't allow that. So let's say it was in the case of Blistex, or if it was in the case of Duchessois or the Drake Hotel, they would have to provide us an exterior finish that would be consistent with their building. And then as part of that review, we have a number of other ordinances that we would use to ensure that, to the best of our ability, that the level of light is kept on the property. There's not light trespass. We've learned a lot about source of light versus light spillage. We do have ordinances in place to regulate sound. We have decibel levels. I think the Plan Commission worked on that a couple years back. So we do have some tools now that we didn't have before. And again, we're going to be updating our zoning code. We have the ability to make even additional changes. So I feel confident that what we have and what we're proposing is a good step to addressing what really the concern was leaving residential areas somewhat at peril to the impacts of a parking deck located next to them. So.
Okay.
In addition, my sense is, Mr. Gallien, that our corporate holders, corporate stakeholders, are sensitive to the needs of the residents around them. Mm-hmm. They want to be good neighbor.
Yes.
And they want to do everything possible to accommodate the wishes and welfare of the neighbors. So just want to assure right. you that we all
right.
are very sensitive to that need.
Right. But then on the flip side,
yes.
you know, you could get a property owner, a corporate entity, let's say the Dutchess Walk Group. They have the ability, you know, they have their corporation, all of their parking is part of their team members that work for that company. When you get a motel, when you get a mall, you have people that are coming and going that really are not, you know, they don't have the same ownership level right. as maybe the corporate entity does. Right. So sometimes then the village, the municipality has to step in and provide those safeguards. So.
Thank you.
Okay, and look, tonight we're here just for the setbacks.
Right. So what'll happen then is I would like, if we could, we could vote this out. It would then go to the zoning board. And the zoning board, we're probably going to have to take a couple months so that we can actually get in contact with some of the businesses that could be impacted by this. So we would contact the mall, we would contact the Dutchess Walk Group, we would contact these various entities that could be impacted so that we're kind of putting them on notice, but also let them be part of the solution so we don't adopt rules in a vacuum. So that would then be, that public hearing would be in front of the zoning board. So
good. Yeah.
So a quick question. So this will apply to only new developments, right? Not the existing.
It would be any new deck or any expansion to an existing deck. So let's take example. Let's take, I don't even know how they do it, but let's say the red deck. Let's say they came up with this ingenious way to move it closer to the Oak Brook Club. They would then be regulated under these provisions. So.
Okay, and then something getting back to Barbara Lang's comments, we could make sure that it's discussed and incorporated into the new zoning ordinance, just so you know that this wouldn't be forgotten. But, you know, like tonight, we're just here for this new setback rule. Okay, would anybody care to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we accept this as written and
as amended.
Four, as amended on yep, item
yep,
four.
Yep.
Okay. A second?
Second.
Okay. Could we have a voice vote, please?
Roll.
Oh, roll call?
Yep.
Doyle?
Yes.
Jane?
Yes.
Lau?
Yes.
Wilczek?
Yes.
Trapinski?
Yes. The amendment is approved by a plan commission, and then the next step would be to go to the zoning board.
Correct.
So I just want to thank everybody that came, Barbara, for coming, and Bill, and the people from the mall. Thank you for your presentation. Okay. So.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is unfinished business. It's the zoning consultant, Tesca Associates. We're going to discuss the comprehensive review of the Village of Oak Brook zoning ordinance. Oh, it's all yours.
Keep it brief. Brilliant.
Thank
and
you.
And be gone.
Rich. Thank you.
I love it.
Thank you.
I couldn't resist saying that.
My sense is you've had enough of zoning. All right. Well, Bob,
okay.
Did you want to?
All right.
Bob, she's got to be. Can you hear me?
Is this on?
Yes. Yeah, you're just when you talk, make sure it's close. So, yeah. So what I'm just going to suggest, and then I'm going to let Khan do all the talking. You know, we've had this in front of you now for a whole bunch of months. We've talked about this, and it's like it's, you know, you get nightmares hearing this. But it's, we've talked about this many, many times. There are a number of big key issues that we went through. I think part of it was an education process to find out really what's in the zoning code and what's not for all of you. My goal would be, after Khan makes his presentation, I would say at a minimum, at the next meeting we have, we need to be prepared to hand this off then to the zoning board. We need to make a motion that we've done, this group has basically done all it can do in terms of making, you know, shepherding some reasonable amendments to the zoning court, and then being able to hand it off to the zoning board so they can start that process of sending it to Ginger Creek and having the homeowners associations come in and tell us what they like and what they don't like. So I think you guys have all done a good job. It's, you did the hard part. You really are providing the foundation for everything that will be going forward. So I'll let Con go from there, and I won't talk anymore.
Thanks, Bob. Well, good to be with you again, and you can see that there's been a lot of work done over the last year plus time, and a lot to your credit in sticking with this process. The zoning process is unique in its detail and the time and attention that it takes, and I know it's a very grueling, so I appreciate everyone hanging in there. What I have attempted to do, and hopefully you've all received now a memo dated May 8th, to distill down for you what we tried to capture with the staff are the, dozen or so core issues that emerged very early on in the process. You may remember, probably going back over a year ago, we had a community meeting where community stakeholders were invited to participate in a workshop. We call it a zoning policies workshop. And if you remember, there were 10 or 12 different zoning policies that were brought to the group, and we were asking for general direction relative to what the community wanted, desired, and didn't like. We took that information.
Hello?
Oh, yeah.
Exactly how this.
Okay. I've lost my train of thought. From the policy workshop, there were a number of issues that were addressed, and from that, from the direction we took, we then worked with you, grouping several chapters together to address each of those issues. Some of the issues fell off the table, one of which I remember was tree preservation. We determined that was not something the community was willing to pursue further. There were others like that. So what is before you is what you have already seen. So all of the information before you tonight is simply taking our previous discussion, your input from those previous meetings, and making the changes, and then simply codifying that information into these new chapters. And so all I'm doing tonight for purposes of refresher, and certainly to give every commissioner an opportunity to weigh in again relative to if what they've seen in this final draft is what obviously you prefer to approve going forward, and any other questions or revisions that you might want us to consider at this point. So using this memo, I'm just going to go through very quickly and highlight what the key changes are, and then certainly respond to any questions or further information you may need. The first one had to do with residential building scale. The discussion was essentially for smaller lots, and smaller lots are characterized here as lots under 1 acre. The concern being with new construction, new teardown activity, the new homes were dwarfing and were generally thought to be incompatible or inconsistent with the character of the existing neighborhoods. What we have done in those instances, we introduced new standards, called them building bulk and design standards for single family development in Chapter 6. Specifically, it's the residential district. It's the end of the residential district. It's reference 1367. And that's a whole new section of the code introducing new standards to control basically the bulk of the building. This is not architecture. This is simply the massing of the building. The one key problem we typically find when we have much larger homes on smaller lots, and I've seen it in many communities where the new homes try to maximize the buildable area of their lot, and means in many cases the facades or the side walls of the homes go up 2.5 stories straight up, with no articulation, no roof line, and so forth. And those tend to be the worst violators. And so the standards that we introduce simply are trying to say, when you're building a new home, two things. Create a pitch to the roof to allow some daylight onto the adjacent property, and also try to match, from a bulk perspective, the design of the home next to you to the extent possible. For the most part, what this really means is to articulate the roof line so you don't have a 2, 2.5, 3-story vertical wall that looks like an office building, not a residential building. And that's really the intent of that section of the code. Now I'm going to take these one at a time.
Can I ask a quick question on that one?
Yeah.
Does this, how does the home association laws and these things there, so how does this play with the different home associations have their own bulking kind of concepts, right?
Right.
So this is going to be the cities and then the homeowners.
Well, Bob or Rebecca may want to weigh in on this, but the rule of thumb is whenever the standards in the village code set the minimum threshold.
Right.
Right? If a homeowners association, through their covenants, usually at the time of development, impose more restrictive standards, then those are imposed and regulated by the homeowners association. Now, again, I defer to the village as to how the permit process works, but that's typically the rule of thumb under zoning.
The challenge, though, is, you know, we've always been taught here that if somebody submits a permit to the village and it meets the village's requirements, at the end of the day, we have to issue it. Now, we have a process in place that we require that there be some communication with your homeowners association, all of yours. We require that there be a letter. But at the end of the day, you could end up with some conflict.
Yep.
Where one wants to do something else and somebody says, well, you know, it meets our code, but it doesn't meet what the homeowners want. And you end up with the stalemate. And then you end up with 100 St. Francis. And you end up with, we have a couple others that you could look at.
We had the same issue, right. Not homeowners. Yeah.
So, you know, I know through the zoning board process, you're going to hear some of the associations go, we think the village should start enforcing your covenants. Yep. That's a... You're going to have to get buy-in from our village attorneys. They don't like that idea at all. And our village board would have to go with that. I mean, that is a tremendous big step to enforce covenants. Because, you know, there's a certain level. You know, I know if people say you can have hold harmless agreements. But, you know, if we get put in a position where you say, we can't approve that compliant fence. But we've already issued 1,000 of those, but you can't do it here. We would probably be subject to some, you know, we would be under the light of the law probably. So
if that was my comment, is we opening a Pandora box by getting into this thing. It's from a village perspective.
Right. And that's the thing, you know, people move in, these people in all of your subdivisions, they move in, you know, they move into the Midwest Club because it has that certain ambience, but it has controls. It has, you know, they have actually FAR controls in the Midwest Club, and your subdivision has certain controls. I know you're shaking
your
head.
And they're subjective. I mean, so then...
Right, but you do have controls, and some people pay extra to live there, you know, and that's fine. But at the end of the day, the hard reality is that if you want to live in one of those subdivisions, that subdivision up to now, it's going to be up to them to enforce those covenants. And that's the challenge. That's the challenge. So, and this kind of discussion goes on in every town that I know that has homeowners associations. The same thing comes up. They talk about it in Naperville, talk about it in another town. So this isn't new just to Oak Brook.
My only recommendation would be we should discuss it with the homeowners association because it needs to be a consistent process across at least an understanding of guiding principles, because otherwise it can create much more misconceptions from an architectural review and who's liable when something gets approved here.
Are we referring to the proposed changes?
Yeah, this one around this, because it gets into the architectural review, because this is stepping into that notion.
Good. Are you coming back? Or are you
I'm going to come down. Yeah, I want to talk to you.
Yeah, which we agree, and that needs to be addressed. Yeah. All right. Is there any other questions on this section?
Do you wish us to hold the questions to the end after you're done with all of them?
No, let's do one by one.
Yeah.
All right.
That's okay.
Well, I know I'm going to be so-called the bad guy here, but this is going the wrong way from a property value standpoint. In 1966, the village code said that you could build up under 22% of your land, and the average size home was 1,100 square feet. Now the average size home is 2,340 square feet, and we're saying you can build on less of your land. So what the village is saying is exactly opposite of what the market is saying. That's only going to lead to depreciation in home values. So it's going the wrong way. People have built these homes because that's what the market's demanding. That's why we're losing these homes to Downers Grove. They'll build a $1 million home there because they don't, especially young people, they don't want big lots. So the more green space you require, the more you're limiting your market of buyers. Therefore, you're lowering your property values.
Okay, for clarification, and I'm not taking position. I mean, this is up to the commission. The clarification is what we are regulating. Well, we're regulating two things. We're regulating building bulk. So it's not talking yet about the amount of coverage that you can put your foundation on. This is literally the bulk of the building, the vertical bulk of the building, and how high you can go up before you have to start moving back from the property line with roof pitches and so forth to respect the light, air, and the architectural character of the neighborhood. The second part of this does relate to coverage, and just let me review that with you so we're all very clear. On sections, I'm in the wrong chapter. Let me switch over here a minute. In chapter 6, the residential section, you'll remember that we introduced a number of tables and graphics to specify more clearly what the requirements were. One of the requirements, as I remember it, was we introduced the notion of maximum lot coverage for the principal structure, meaning the main house. I think they already had FAR, if I remember correctly. Is that, Rebecca, is that? I don't think we introduced that.
Not in the residential district.
Not in residential? So that was new. See, I don't have, mine doesn't have that highlighted, so I couldn't remember. So we now have an FAR requirement.
Excuse me, it is in the residential districts, but only for non-residential uses, not for single-family dwellings.
Thank you. So now we have both in the residential an FAR coverage and a maximum lot coverage for principal uses. And you're correct, Rebecca, the FAR coverage, and I'm just looking, for instance, at the R1, it applies to the non-residential use. So FAR does not apply to a normal residence on that property. Let me just do a quick scan. Yeah, that's the same for R2. Yeah, I think it's pretty much across the board. So what has happened, and I think this is also fairly uniform, that for the single-family residential districts, we now introduce, and I believe this was the new thing, to address the concerns some people had in the community, and I think this was the consensus, I'll admit, this was not universal, relative to the amount of coverage on a building and the loss of open space and potential flooding and other issues. And for residential uses, a maximum lot area coverage, principal structures only, of 0.2. And that does not include the garage, the shed, or other potential accessory structures that are allowed in the rear yard and other yards. So I just wanted to clarify where we are with regard to those requirements.
Right, and when the code was written in 1966, we were at 20.22. So okay. We just lowered it. You know, it's just going the wrong way. The market is saying people want bigger homes and less land. We're saying, no, we're going to tell people they can't have bigger homes, they got to have more land. It's not going to work. you'll have it, but right. You're going to pay for it with your values.
Now, of course, this should be obvious, but maybe it's important to point out that the amount of coverage on the lot, the constant is the 0.2. As the lot increases, the home size increases. So it does allow for larger homes. I mean, it's relational. As the lot increases, the home gets bigger. I think the concern, again, like with the architectural bulk controls, it's for the smaller lots, the overbuilding on the smaller lots. I don't think this is an issue of trying to control the ultimate size of the house, because now we have something, a standard that's proportional across all different types. So, you know, my point is, if you want a larger home, that is possible. You just simply have to build on a larger lot.
Well, why are we addressing it? What's the concern we're trying to address?
The two things. It was the first address, the bulk, the massing, and the impact of the character of that on the neighborhood and the adjacent property. And then the second, the coverage had to do with the loss of open space. Now, the coverage, over pavement of lots, because you got to remember, on a lot, not only you have your principal and your accessory structures, you have all the other paved surfaces, right? Your driveway, your patio, and on the smaller lots, the message we were getting, again, consensus, not universal, was that there was too much of the lot was being paved over, creating not only loss of green space, but creating drainage problems and flooding, potentially. And just for perspective, I've done enough of these to say that this 0.2 FAR is not unusual. I would say it's probably a fairly common standard in the communities that we've worked with. 0.2, 0.25, I mean, somewhere in that range. So it's not out of the ballpark.
My reference would be Hinsdale, Downers Grove, Elmhurst. You could build a 4,000 square foot home on a 50 by 150 lot. With Oak Brook having a minimum lot of 18,000 square feet, you would never have the density that those communities have. But that's where people are building their new homes. They don't want the open land to the excess. So I'm just saying, I understand what this is, a consensus, it's a group. Right. I just wanted to go on record to say it will impact the property values going forward.
Madam Chair,
go ahead.
I do understand the concern of my Planning Commission member. But again, I hate to bring up this. Oak Brook is not Hinsdale, and it's not Downers Grove. That's what differentiates us. So if people want to know it, they know it beforehand, what they're getting into it. We're not forcing anything. Okay, if your lot is 1,800 square feet, then you can build single family home or double family if you want, bi-level or mix. You know, you can build up to 2,000 feet, which I see it here. So it's up to the choice of the buyer and the person who's trying to move in the Oak Brook. He understands when he's getting into it, what would be his resale value of the property will be in future if he's building it. So I think from my perspective, I understand where my fellow member is coming from, but that is not an issue. I think we have talked about this, and this is a never-ending battle. We can put it in, is not going to, because the person who is coming in, he knows beforehand what he's getting into it. As simple as that. Thank you.
Because, Rebecca, the next step would be really the zoning board then takes us to all the homeowners. Then we start getting their input on all this.
Procedurally for the text amendment?
Right.
That is correct. In fact, as Bob's kind of put forth the vision, it will be a joint meeting between the Plan Commission and the Zoning Board, and so it'll be an opportunity for them to see the rationales that were put forward as part of the discussion. So they'll be able to see, as Tesca has presented it, and I think that because they'll have the minutes, and obviously that'll reflect how various Plan Commissioners feel about these issues, they'll be able to see that as well. And then it will go towards a public hearing as part of the Zoning Board once the Plan Commission has handed it off.
All right.
And then ultimately, obviously, it goes to the trustees, who will also have opinions and concerns raised about these issues, as well as the village attorney.
Okay, so this is really like a good first step. But, you know, with the caveat that when we meet again with the zoning board and get some input from the homeowners association, it will add to the discussion.
Correct. We expect that it will only these issues that Con has kind of captured in this two-page summary are the issues that were brought forth, from my understanding, from the various workshops. And so we wanted to show where those were being, at least at the beginning phases of language was being put together as presented, so that there is some talking of it. It's a good opportunity to have a starting point as to what's been changed in the zoning ordinance.
So for the record, I totally support Ken, and I feel we're going in the wrong direction, and I think we're making it more complicated. So I would like to put that in the.
I would also suggest, though, that if the commission would like to, Con can revise as the draft further, and if and when it comes back that the entities that wanted this type of issue addressed. Ask as to what happened, Con will be able to explain that language was discussed at the Plan Commission and it wasn't supported. I think that if anything, if there are objects in this draft that this commission no longer feels support for or questions the need for, you can at least make that known.
Yeah, I just want to add to the discussion here, because I'm with Dr. Lal, because Oak Brook was founded as more of a place in the country. And that's why we have bigger lots, and there are people here that want bigger lots, but what happens to them as they sell their property?
Well, we have heard the stories here before.
Yeah.
But they knew it beforehand. But the main issue Mr. Khan pointed out, the recommendation here is mainly for adjacent properties, daylight, plain standards that he's talking about.
Right.
He's not talking about the size. I mean, that's the main thing, is the pitch of the roof. So we don't build so high, so it blocks the light of the adjoining property.
Yeah.
That's what is the issue. Am I correct?
I don't know if
Well, it's both. It's okay. Both that and it's the lot coverage. So lot coverage does regulate to some extent the size. Now, even you said 18,000. I was trying to look that up. Is it 18,000 is the smallest
yes.
lot?
Yes. Yeah, that's
right. So at a 2 FAR on 18,000, if my math is right, you can have a 36,000.
100.
3,600. Thank you. 3,600.
Right.
Square foot footprint, which means if you go up two stories, that's now 5,200 square feet of building area. I can't imagine,
no.
in that district, that would be more than enough house for most people. So even with a 0.2, because your lots are big, if you were on a lot as you described, or some of the smaller lots in some of the more urban neighborhoods, I would tend to agree with you, and 0.22 may be too tight. But I just don't see on 18,000 square feet that this is really a burden in terms of marketability. But
I'd just like to clarify one thing. I'm not comparing Oak Brook to Hinsdale or Downers Grove. What I'm saying is we compete for the same market of buyers. There are people that would move into this general area of those communities, and property values are based on supply and demand. So the more you limit your market, the less demand you have, and that's how it lowers property values. I'm not trying to compare us to Hinsdale or Elmhurst or Downers Grove. I'm trying to say we compete for the same market of buyers, and if we limit our market of buyers, it can affect our property value. I just wanted to clarify that.
It's a good point, and I remember early on in this conversation, we did talk about, and I don't know where it would be applied, although within planned developments, I do believe we now have a provision in planned developments to allow a mix of residential uses to address. The issue was, should we have a district that allowed for smaller lots in the community, to begin to address, I believe, some of the point of the market, because there's, even at 18,000 square feet, how many people are still going to buy that lot? And I believe the way we address that, I'll have to look back into it, is that we do allow what we call mixed-use development as a PUD, as a form of a planned development, which would allow for a range of lot types, residential types, from a townhome to smaller single family. And I know you have various models in your community of cluster housing and of developments that actually where the home sits on a smaller lot, but there's more open space around it. So I believe that would still be possible, and the way we've written the code would allow for that as an option going forward. So I think that in some part addresses this issue of less available marketable properties for that buyer.
I just want to add one other point too. Where Elmer's Hospital used to be, the old Elmer's Hospital, they had these big, beautiful homes, and they're so close together, and that's a perfect example of what occurs when the density is too tight, because you do have what we're talking about here, an infringement of sunlight and air circulating around the buildings. In fact, I don't see how some of those owners can even appreciate their own building, because they can't step back far enough even to look at what their building looks like as it's all packed in. So I just wanted to just bring that up. It's something to consider.
Right. Yeah, the only other point I wanted to make is that if I, as a person making a decision to build here, I'm just saying it's becoming more and more complicated for me to figure out what is the code, because I will first go to the city, then I'll go to my own homeowners association, and by the time I get any decision, it's 1 year down the road, and the cost, the opportunity cost for me to make a decision would be just higher and higher. And to Ken's point, people will move away, because my objective is we need to make life simpler for people, not more complicated. I understand what we want to control, but everybody is trying to control, and we're just putting more and more controls. The homeowners association is putting more controls. The city is putting more controls. So we need to just get an understanding of what do we want to control for and simplify it, because right now it'll take more time to get the building permit. Then you will have the same process repeated by the homeowners association. And that's what's happening today. That's reality. So that's all I'm saying is let's not make our codes more complicated. Everybody's trying to, I mean, I'm a part of the homeowners association at Trinity Lakes. We have our own architectural review. We watch it. We watch for the wind. We look at the samples of the roof. We look at the samples of the stones. We look at the samples of the things. I mean, come on. I mean, at the end of the day, nobody will come and build it here then. So that's all my point is. Let's not make it so much more complicated that people get lost in the process.
Okay.
I would also...
Well, I have to make a comment on that. I fully agree. But as a cardiac surgeon, you don't want to decrease the quality. All right? So I have to throw that in. And I'm not trying to boast anything. But somewhere we have to have standards. Yeah. Well, if you want to meet those standards, because that's what quality requires, then you know beforehand these are the standards. If you want them, please join us. Simple as that.
Tom?
Naveen, I would just make the comment. I think part of the reason we get make things, in a sense, more complicated is so that the whole process will become more simple. Because if things are down on paper and people say, okay, this is what it is, bang. I don't come before a board like this, and then I have 30 neighbors coming in saying, no, you can't do that because it wasn't clear from the beginning.
What do you understand?
You know, and I just feel that, you know, that's what we're after is, you know,
simplify.
We complicate things initially so that it's more simple in the process. Like we're going to possibly go to a plan and zoning board. So we've taken one whole step out of the whole process. Mm-hmm. Now, it complicates things to do that a little bit, but the ultimate result is something I think is a little more simple. Anyway, my comment, that's all.
Okay, move on.
Okay.
Next step.
I'm sorry, Ken, not to cut you off. But just so that everyone is clear, though, if there were things in here that you want to revise, this is just the working draft so that the language can be changed. Just...
Because maybe some of us could think about stuff and then...
And maybe make it as part of the joint meeting as well.
Okay.
So again, it's a draft. It's not It's not written in stone until it's adopted by the trustees.
And the other last parting comment, I believe there are some areas of the village where there are no HOA, or the HOA standards are so old or out of date, or...
In some cases, you have assessment plats where you don't have a ruling subdivision, homeowners
association. In fact, I think that's also the issue, right, where the smaller lots are and where more of these issues tend to arise.
I totally agree. That's why I'm recommending that the homeowners association and the village should jointly address this whole architectural review thing, is what I'm saying. So at the end goal is we simplify the overall process, but not look at it in silos.
Okay. Well, hopefully the next one's a lot simpler. Telecommunications. The current code was essentially silent on the issue of telecommunication towers and antenna relative to regulations. Although the federal government does have restrictions to some extent on what we can and cannot do, we do have certain authority over location and design and, well, let's just say location for the moment. So, and where to put these facilities. So in this chapter, it's in Chapter 3, which is the general provision. Specifically, we introduced a new section, 13-318, to address this. The proposed regulations now allow for telecommunication facilities as a special use, so there's still review, in ORA1, ORA2, which is the office research assembly districts, your office districts, O3, O4, and the B3 district, and are prohibited in all the other districts. So we do allow them. It's in a discrete number, particularly in those districts. Generally, I believe, if I remember the districts correctly, that abut or adjoin highway interstate corridors, where obviously these don't have a direct impact on residents. I think for the most part, we tried to stay away from putting these next to people's homes where we could, obviously the tall towers. So unless you have any other discussions, that's simply just a note indicating, again, a reminder that this is something new to the code. Ready to move on?
Yeah.
Okay. Next, digital signs. We had, and I remember this very clearly, a fair amount of discussion, even at the policy workshop, over should we and should we not have digital signs, and where they would be appropriate and not appropriate, and if they were allowed, what would the design be, and so forth and so on. The end of the day, the consensus was, and it wasn't just, by the way, for business entities. There was interest from the community, for community events, from your park district, for recreational events and so forth, to allow this type of use. Although still be highly regulated and designed and controlled as any other ground sign would be controlled, and there are additional standards added. So what we ended up with in Chapter 11, and there are all this, although my memo says there's definitions in Chapter 2, that's wrong. There was actually definitions in Chapter 11. As well. The basic issue is we have allowance for digital signs. We talked about them as an approved type of sign classification and structural type. And this is, by the way, in section 13.11.5 and then 13.11.8, where we specifically also allow them in the B1 and B3 districts. And the B2, sorry, I wanted to clarify that, also allowed in the B2 district. So we, again, strictly regulated with regard to illumination, the height, size, and so forth, the amount of message that can be, you know, scrolling and so forth. But these are now introduced as something that were previously, if I believe correctly, prohibited, or at least were not mentioned, now are allowed, and it's referred to as an automatic, I think it's an automatic changeable copy sign is the definition we've given to that, which is typical of how these signs are defined in most communities. Any other discussion or debate over that? Okay. Next, outdoor sales and food trucks. Two separate but also related issues. Two separate parts of the code address this in your business districts. Chapter 7, relative to outdoor sales, is specifically 13.7.5. There's a number of things we did to regulate that, and let me bring it up because I don't have all my bullets listed here, so just let me revisit that. 13.7 sales. All right. Case in point. Tonight's special use, once this is adopted, will no longer happen. We specifically now allow outdoor dining areas adjacent to restaurants in districts where outdoor dining areas are permitted and approved by the Office of Development Services, which means it takes it away from the special use process and puts it in the hands of staff to review. So that's significant. Again, in the bigger theme of trying to be streamlining, make this efficient, as Naveen said earlier, easier code to work with, and don't delay development within the community where it's just not necessary. The other area we addressed under outdoor sales is in the area of food trucks. We now allow food trucks as a special use. This is specifically referencing 13.7.5. And we allow them for community events and for recreational events by the park district. And we also allow them under, again, highly regulated and specific requirements. And again, I believe everything has to be approved by the, let me reread this to make sure I got it right, by the Director of Development Services. So this would not only be reviewed there, but all food and vending trucks also have to be approved by the DuPage County Health Department as well, and they have to get a special permit for that. And so they are highly regulated. So bottom line is food trucks are now introduced as a permitted activity in addition for special community events and functions allowed, obviously, you know, by the village in your business and office districts as well.
Con, I know when we had this discussion, we did mention about a distance from an actual restaurant. Is that in there?
Yeah, let me go back to that. I'll read you what the specific requirements are.
500 feet.
We have hours of operation. Yes, mobile food vending vehicles shall not be within 500 feet of a restaurant contained in a permanent structure. Okay.
We had a big
is that what you were referring to?
Yeah.
Perfect.
All right. Any other comments under food trucks? The next one under
Con?
Yeah.
The definition. In the definition section in Chapter 1 of mobile food vending, it's just a bit unclear.
Okay.
And I think maybe to look at that because it's like there are two separate statements in there, like two different definitions of mobile food vending. The other comment on that is in the list of places where you can have this.
All right.
It seems to me that, for example, the soccer program that goes on here in the village would not be allowed to have, it's not one of the permitted uses because that's not, as I understand it, it's not a nonprofit. And so, and it's not a park district thing. So
let me read you ordinance says now and see if this is sufficient. Food trucks are allowed in the following locations: at recreational and community events sponsored by the village, local taxing districts, homeowners association, local civic and religious organizations as approved by the Office of Development Services. So it seems to me that's a fairly broad catch-all to include the soccer organizations and other.
But technically, I don't, if that's a privately, and I believe it is a privately controlled group.
Right.
It doesn't fit the definition.
Would a local civic or religious organization?
That would not be a local civic. It, first of all, local is, by definition means it's within the borders of Oak Brook.
Okay.
I mean, I'm just.
Right.
I'm
operates just, within the.
Right. And I don't think their offices are here in the village of Oak Brook. So I'm just saying, I think it just take a look at it and see whether the wording should be adjusted.
To allow for. Okay.
You know, and maybe Bob has an answer. And he said,
let me make a note here and expand definition for.
I guess you could even just put in sports or something related to sporting events that are at.
You know, whatever wording would be good, but we don't want to exclude them if someone, you know, just want to. You know, be inclusive, not exclusive.
Right.
Sporting organizations operating rather than necessarily their main right. office being
or
located.
Approved sporting. Approved sporting yeah. events. Or.
You want to specify non-profit?
There's something to the effect of sporting organizations operating within the. Within the village. Approved, you said? Approved. Who approves?
No, it already says approved, so yeah. That would be too
repetitive.
Well,
the events would be approved by the.
As approved by the Office of Development right. Services, correct.
Okay. Well, yeah, we'll make that change to expand the types of organizations that are allowed here that are clearly operating. Okay. The other thing I was going to mention relative to this section, I didn't highlight earlier under outdoor storage or outdoor sales, sorry. What we did prohibit is there was some discussion about vending machines. And so vending machines, including but not limited to the dispensing of food, rental movies, or other multimedia beverages and other goods and service for retail trade, are not allowed outdoors. That was something specifically came up.
Excuse me, but thinking back through that local civic, the 5Ks or the events that are held on properties, I guess it would just be civic organizations if they're, you know, maybe you take the word local away.
You take the word, that might work.
All right. Oh, shoot, hold on. I want to make sure I keep track of what I'm doing. Okay. Save this as a different version, so I don't. Okay. Next, outdoor storage, recreational vehicles. This came up in my memory with certain homeowners associations, certain neighborhood groups having concerns over the storage of recreational vehicles, either allowing them or not allowing them was the debate. The memory is that the consensus was to allow them, but again, allow them under very limited circumstances. And so what is done in the code is essentially under section 13.6.3 in chapter 6, for residential uses. Recreational vehicles are allowed in the residential area, in residential areas or on residential lots, if vehicles are located, our vehicles are not located in any building area or required yard, and located on lots of 1 acre or more in size. And then there are other standards for screening and setbacks and so forth, including that the recreational vehicle cannot be parked, if you will, in front of a garage hanging out in the front yard. If it has to be enclosed, or if it's on the side yard, it has to be pushed back so that it doesn't extend in front of the facade of the building. And then, of course, it has to be screened, fencing, or landscaping. That's assuming you have a lot wide enough to do that.
Just a clarification. So if I understand correctly, what you're saying is you're allowed, as long as it is not in the front of the facade.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
And what is the second condition?
Located on lots 1 acre or more in size. So if you have a lot...
less than 1 acre, you cannot have it.
That's right. As an outdoor storage. Now, you can certainly, if your garage was big enough, nothing stops you from having a recreational vehicle and putting in your garage. That's fine. We're saying those things that are stored outside. The next, you've hit on it earlier, there are a number of reasons why we had discussed and ultimately recommended to you the combination of the Plan Commission and Zoning Board processes to create a more efficient, predictable, and less expensive process to go through and, quite frankly, to reduce and eliminate redundancies in the review process. And the consensus was that was, in fact, what you preferred to do. All we did now by creating what is now called a Planning and Zoning Commission is literally the consolidation of your two boards. How that's done, who sits on it, the composition, so forth, obviously that has to be worked out. But that now is addressed in Chapter 14, and the Zoning Board of Appeals no longer exists. Under temporary signs, a number of things were addressed largely. Oop, yep.
Just a comment. It relates to this, but it's in the actual text. It shows up in Chapter 10. But there's a regular reference to the Director of Development Services or his designee. And the language suggests like a czar. And I think it would be softer and more palatable to especially the village board if we talked about the Office of Development Services rather than the Director of, because then you have to say, well, then the question becomes, well, you know, what if the director's not there? You know, God, we have a crisis. But, you know, if the designation is to the office, it gives the people who work there a lot more flexibility about how things are done and less ability for it to be challenged. Mm. Someone will say, well, it wasn't approved by the director, it was approved by, you know, someone who's, you know, a minion down there someplace. You know, that kind of thing. And I think if the reference is rather to the office, because that's what we're focusing on, is what the office is going to do, as opposed to, you know, this one person
presiding everything, I see.
I don't know, it's just a thought. I just think it's a softer, it fits better into, if my perspective, it fits better into, you know, what we're trying to do.
Okay, any thoughts?
So the recommendation here is that we combine the planning and the
Zoning Board of Appeals.
Board of Appeals into one.
Yes.
That's simplification, I like that.
Yeah, that was one of the big red flags when we did the initial review, and this has come up before. We don't think we're certainly the first ones to raise it. And this, again, in many communities we work with now, this seems becoming more and more of a trend as you're finding less and less need for zoning boards because they deal with such limited issues with regard to variations. And often variations, when they do come up, often are in the context of a planning project. So.
Makes sense.
And also, what we're trying to do is streamline a number of other features in the code by adding standards, by clarifying, so removing questions, removing things like outdoor dining. So those don't have to come. So we're empowering, basically, the staff with more authority to take care of the day-to-day stuff.
That's great. Yep.
There's a number of ways that we're doing that, but this is obviously the big one. Okay. The next section, classification sign types, temporary signs. A number of changes were done in response to a recent court action, all the way up to the Supreme Court, relative to what you can and can't do relative to controlling temporary signs. And so the chapter 11 now deals with this in numbers of ways to do that. The local issues, typically the concerns is over quality, location, duration. The proposed regulations generally now allow temporary signs if they're limited to 30 days in a calendar year. And we're not, you know, the issue is you can't say, well, you're allowed this type of temporary sign and not that type of temporary sign. You can't control content, and the court's been very clear about that. You can control size, duration, time, location, all those things we can control. Design, color, I mean, pretty much everything else. So just something you should be aware of, because I know that's come up before. Site plan review. This isn't
I had a question about that.
Oh, yeah, on the signs?
Do we really want to limit real estate signs to 30 days in a calendar year?
For each individual house? Let me look that up and see what it says. Because that might have been a catch-all for all temporary signs. I don't know if real estate signs had a separate provision. Give me a minute to pull that up.
As I recall, we had a rather long discussion about real estate signs, didn't we?
We did.
Yeah. Real estate signs are separately defined.
11.5.
So they wouldn't be subject to that 30 days?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
All right.
I was trying to find that to verify for myself. Let's see, it's not a structural type, is it?
No, it's before that. It's item 22 in classification.
It's a functional type?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry, I saw it, and I wanted to go and look at it within the districts themselves.
Right. Let's see.
Correct. Number 21 and 22 under classifications of signs. And then...
I don't see anything relative to timing.
Signs, yes.
It's a description, and then it also has it's more of a definition between a standard size and a real estate sign that's a large size. And then it refers to the district regulations for size, but in terms of duration,
the only reason I was asking is in the handout that you provided, it just says that when it talks about temporary signs, it says these can include political signs, short-term or event signage, real estate signs, and an A-frame or sandwich signs. I just wanted to make sure we weren't limiting real estate signs to 30 days in a calendar year.
Right. Right now, I don't have a quick answer for you. All I know is that temporary signs do have a 30-day limitation. The intent is those signs that are in business districts, not generally residential. The problem is I don't yet find, although we define real estate signs separately, so real estate signs is different than a temporary sign. So one answer would be the limitation for temporary sign, because it has its separate definition for real estate sign, would seem not to apply. But I'm trying to look for a specific answer to see if there is a limitation on real estate signs. And I don't, let me use signs without a permit.
But I agree with Commissioner Wilczek that previously the temporary signage that it's under in the business district is the same language that's currently used for the leasing signs. So it may just be something, Con, that we'll have to make a note to make sure that it's not limited the length of time for residential real estate signs, and not just for residential, but maybe just for real estate signs in general, if they're going to be handled as temporary signs. Because temporary signs in the office districts are allowed for 12 months.
Thank you.
So what do you suggest, how long it would be?
I would think you'd have to at least give them 6 months.
Okay, I mean, that's what I'm trying to find out. What is the norm is?
I don't think there isn't. I mean, it could be there years, but depending on how hard your house is to sell. I mean, you think of that property at Midwest and 31st, it took them a long time to sell that, and without a sign, they don't have a hope.
Why limit the time for real estate? I mean, the average days on the market is pretty high right now for especially the higher-end houses.
Right. It's dependent, I think, if you're talking about the residential or the commercial.
Residential, we talk about.
Right. Yeah. Because I think there was an internal staff discussion, and I'm not sure if there was an external one, but the idea of having leasing signs, renewing them, was to make sure that the commercial district was, you know, being actively pursuing it.
So this does not cover the residential real estate, is what we say.
What I was noting was that temporary signage in the business districts within this sign regulations was handled as temporary signs.
Okay.
In the residential district regulations, there's neither discussed. There's temporary ground signs for residential subdivisions shall be permitted in accordance with the following, but I don't know if any of those specifically highlight a real estate type signage. I would also note that we regularly don't receive any complaints about residential real estate signs, so.
You're right, they probably will, but how else do you say, I mean, my circuit is home, but then it's.
Hey, Ma.
Did I miss anything?
You sure did.
Thanks.
I don't see any limitation in residential either.
Yeah, it's not something that I think comes up very regularly.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. I just
of course, now that I say that, it'll be tomorrow's call, you know.
Yeah, I think the intent was, it's a good call, the intent was to regulate in the commercial area.
Good enough.
Makes sense.
Okay. All right. The next section, it's a new chapter, Chapter 10, Site Plan Review. This codifies, essentially, a number of the practices the staff and your group, ZBA, have already been doing relative to the review of projects. So this, to Naveen's question earlier about, well, it seems more complicated, but Tom, you're saying more complicated only to be more simple, was a good explanation, because by codifying the standards, now everyone knows specifically what they are. There's no running around, there's no second guessing, it's very clear, and what the procedures are for site plan review, which would be a review process that would be largely a staff function at this time. So now we have codified in this section not only standards for placements of buildings and parking, but also landscaping within parking lots, landscaping within the perimeter areas. The new chapter is intended for all non-single family. This includes multifamily projects. And it also includes recommendations for green best practices, mm-hmm. bioswales, roof gardens, other things that can be done, pervial pavers and other things. Again, these are recommended guidelines, not requirements. You don't have to build a green roof, but it is a guideline for both commission to consider as well as an owner.
Makes sense.
All right, so, and again, this is a growing practice amongst communities to have this type of a process.
Makes sense.
Another big issue is surfaced during this process is the issue, and I understand in response to a court case, the definition, what distinguishes a medical clinic versus a doctor offices. And as explained here, typically the doctor offices are the smaller, the clinics are larger, with more traffic, more turnover. This difference is recognized in the village's parking requirements, interestingly enough, where medical uses demand more parking than business offices, which, you know, business office, think of a small doctor's practice, would be more typical. The new definitions provided in Chapter 2 and also the way in which we regulate where medical uses and doctor office are allowed, either by as a permitted use or as a special use, in the table that we've created, and we can refer to that in a minute, clarify the distinction between those uses, and I'll refer to that in a minute. I have to pull it up. Clinics are allowed in limited number, in a limited, write that down, in a limited number of business and office districts. All right. So let me pull that up so we can first look at what the definition says. Going back, verse 2, a doctor's office is a medical facility which is not a medical clinic and consists up to four treatment rooms, either general practitioners or specialists, which receive and treat patients. Patients at a doctor's office are typically visiting for regular checkups and do not require any intense form of hospitalization. Medical clinic a healthcare facility that is not a doctor's office, but is primarily devoted to the care of outpatients who are treated without staying at the facility overnight. Either publicly or privately owned medical clinics typically cover the primary health care needs of the population, catching all these little things, within the community. And then relative to where they are allowed, we go back to the business district. No, sorry. It's not in the business, in the general provisions. It's in the use table in the general provisions, I believe. Let me see if I can find it. Wrong on that, too. Let's try chapter. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's in chapter 4. Yeah, chapter 4. Can't read my own notes. A minute to pull that up.
While you're looking at it, so effectively we're saying is the medical facilities will have need more parking than businesses, basically.
Right. The demand,
and then giving guidelines
of medical facilities, the impact. Normal office buildings that might have a few doctor practitioners aren't suited.
Right.
The parking isn't sufficient to provide for that more intensive use.
So this must have been benchmarked with other cities. Others may have done that, right?
So let me just pull up the table and I can find where those uses are allowed so you understand where they are allowed and not allowed. Clinics, special use in the B1, B2, B3, and the ORA1, which is your office research, and the O4, so a very limited number of districts. And doctor's offices, I don't believe we distinguish doctor offices from other types of offices, from other types of professional offices. Let me see if there's a separate distinction for doctor. No, I think they're included as part of business and professional offices and allowed where you would expect them in all of your commercial and all of your office and office research districts. So they're allowed by right and they're more permissive because by definition, they are smaller operations, have a smaller impact, smaller footprint. A clinic, different operation, bigger footprint, higher traffic demand, therefore special use and also limited in certain districts. Any other questions? All right, next one, definition of family. We touched on this a little bit. Regarding the issue of extended families occupying homes, and basically the issue is increasing the capacity of and the crowding of existing facilities. What we propose in under the definition section for both family and the definition of dwelling units is that the proposed regulations require full facilities with each dwelling unit for a family and allow up to 3 unrelated persons living plus 2 guests. And I believe some of that was already true with the code, so let me bring up the definition in a minute of family and what the change was. family. One person or two or more persons, each related to the other by blood, marriage legal, or a group of not more than three persons, not also related, together with their domestic servants, household, maintaining a common household dwelling unit. The family may include, in addition to the previous, not more than two roomers, boarders, or permanent guests. That, I believe, was a modification largely to what the code already had in place. I don't know there was actually much change. And then the definition of a dwelling unit, which relates to that, the change made it clear that a dwelling unit is one or more rooms which are arranged, designed, or used as living quarters for one family only. Individual bathrooms and complete kitchen, single kitchen facilities permanently installed to serve the entire family shall always be included within each dwelling unit. So basically a dwelling unit has to be a self-sustaining, you can't have a separate unit attached with someone living there without having full services to that unit. And once you do, it's defined, by definition, defined as a separate dwelling unit. And of course, we know you can only have one dwelling unit on a lot. So that controls how many additional members of the family or extended family or so forth or so on, or guests or boarders can occupy a residential home.
So we are protecting against people building connected dwelling units and then renting them out. That's what we're trying to protect against.
And it also applies, thank you, to the issue of the Airbnb and other.
Right, exactly. That's
it. Con? As I understand it, at least the way I've heard you explain it, it would be perfectly acceptable for a couple, a man and a woman married. They have, let's say they have four children.
Why married?
Because that establishes the relationship. And each of the mother and the father, they each have their parents living with them.
Yes.
So we're up to 10 people now, and they have cousins who want to stay with them for an extended period of time, and there are four of those. So we're up to 14 people, but even with those 14 people, there's no requirement for any kind of separate facilities, because they are related by blood.
Mm-hmm.
So it's...
Plus you add...
the couple boarders.
Together with their domestic servants, maintaining a common household dwelling unit. So it's not more than one unit. So it's including a one or who knows how many, but servants for that house. In addition, the family may include not more than two roomers, boarders, or permanent guests, whether or not gratuitous, meaning whether or not they're paying for that facility. So you can add on to that number, correct?
No, what I'm saying, is this what we
intend? But you cannot build the home, my understanding, and this is where Bill Hudson may need to come in at some point, my understanding, you cannot build the home attached to it like a mother-in-law unit, right? You understand? Or a separate dwelling unit that has all the functional facilities as a freestanding unit. So 14 people share one kitchen. Right?
No. No, Con. We would allow multiple kitchens.
Oh, you do? But
yes.
Oh, okay.
It is more of an access issue, so that there is no way to... Yeah, you may not have it to be a separate structure. Would allow multiple kitchens within one house. Okay. It's just you can't... There are literally five standards that Bill uses to determine if it's a unit, a dwelling unit.
My real question is,
are we restricting in any way, or do we want to restrict in any way, the total number of people that can live in one dwelling unit? Because you can get up to a big, you can get up to a pretty high number that are related by blood, adoption, or legal adoption, or marriage.
Correct.
So you can get up to a big number of people. Right. Now, do we want to say, okay, that's okay, or do we want to create some kind of limit?
And if you create a limit, how would you enforce it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Rebecca, what I heard you say, and this is why I'm trying to understand, the strategic intent of this is to limit Airbnb and people building multiple dwelling units and renting them out, right? And that's why the solution that we have proposed here is access points. If you limit the access points, you can have multiple places, then you can't have multiple units, right? Is that, I'm just trying to understand.
You know, the difficulty with, and I understand, you know, there are, we've had a number of circumstances in town whereby there's accusations made that there are too many people within a dwelling unit, that there's too many unrelated people mm-hmm. in a dwelling unit. And when you get those complaints, it's really, really difficult to enforce. One of the first things you have to be able to do, you know, especially with overcrowding, you have to be able to get a court order to go into their dwelling and actually determine that. And for a judge to actually issue a court order, that's very rare. I mean, you hear about it occasionally in, you know, Elgin, or I'm not picking on them, or mm-hmm. in Joliet or Aurora, where they will have literally many, many families living in mm-hmm. one house. But again, it has to go literally quite overboard before you can get any judicial relief. So, you know, we've done a pretty good job, you know, with Bill and trying to not allow someone to create multiple dwelling units within these big houses. And it's worked pretty well. Again, I would love to hear what our attorney has to say. Because at the end
deal,
of the day,
yeah.
it comes down to, no matter what we have here, mm-hmm. it has to be worth enforcing or being capable of being enforced.
Well, I'm saying is right now, the way it's worded, there's basically very little restriction on the total number of people that live in the dwelling unit. I'm not saying we should change it or not, right. but I'm saying that's in effect what we're...
But as an example, like what I said earlier tonight, I think that would be a good thing to flag. If you guys make a motion to move it forward, let's say at your next meeting, that you would like to have the zoning board really have analysis and input from the village attorney right. relative to that family definition. There was some concerns raised by you that possibly this could be abused. And they can, you know, kind of yep. puts them on notice that it's an issue for okay. discussion.
Perfect. Yep.
I think it's a good idea.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's all I have.
Excellent.
Is there anything else that you have questions about in the revisions or anything that we might have missed at this point? But
I have a few comments, Connor. Just I actually read through most of all those things. And
oh,
don't ever ask us to do that again, please. Just in chapter one, where you talk about building coverage, you use the word principles, and I think you mean principle, ending P-A-L, not P-L-E. You might just want to check that.
Good catch.
In the definition of sign political, you know, questionably whether it's legal, practical, and enforceable how, because it says you can't put a political sign in a public right-of-way, period. And how is that in any way enforceable?
Well, here's the problem. Having been through many elections here, we have streets that are village streets. I think the village has every right to control what gets put in its street or its right of way. So we can control right. that. But I know DuPage County, like with Midwest okay. Road, Myers Road,
No control.
31st Street, there have been years where there's lots and lots of signs, and then there's other years where they pluck them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know quite what the state does, because the state, part of 22nd Street is in Oak Brook. Some of it's in Oak Brook Terrace, but nobody's quite sure which is which. So it all depends on that other jurisdiction. I mean, we could say whatever I want, but we don't have a right to go to and take signs out of DuPage County right away. I think that's up for them to do that. Same thing with the state. So,
well, I haven't seen the abuse of the duration of the political signs in the neighborhood. In Myers Road, I know, back of Ginger Creek, you know, the neighbors pretty know each other well, so they watch. And even in 22nd Street, during the election, you will see a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. Within a week, all the sign disappears. So
I mean, it's, and again, the whole issue of political signs, over the years, we've had a number of attorneys. And, you know, the caution is, you know, that's free speech. You know, you guys can control maybe how big it is, or you can control maybe where it gets put, but you can't really control what it says. And, you know, that becomes...
I don't
that
know that we allow any signs in the public right of way.
Right,
I mean,
right.
So I don't know that we're necessarily picking anything on definition. We're calling out the sign type, but I don't think that sign type would be treated in any... Like, I think the particular case that went all the way to Supreme Court was an issue regarding a church.
Yep.
That put a sign in the right of way to, as a directional sign, right, to announce, you know, my church is this way, and the community said no, and they won because it
was famous
content related. You can't, because it's an off-premise sign,
sure,
right? And they said no, you can't do that. So they had to, you know, you have to have one regulation applies to every sign, and just it's clean, right? Just to remove it from all signs. So
in theory, a political sign is no different than a real estate sign.
Right.
That's no different than, you know, hire Joe Blow to mow your lawn. I mean, a sign is a sign. And the courts now have been pushing municipalities to say, it doesn't matter what that sign says. I mean, that town of Gilbert's case, they pretty much slapped all municipalities that your sign codes are pretty much all illegal if you follow that say that one sign is okay, but something else isn't.
Right. And so, that's what we tried to address within the structure that you have. Yep. I mean, if it was talked to Rebecca about this, if we had more time and money, we'd just completely redo the whole thing.
Right.
But we did try to make it more content neutral so that we're regulating by size, not necessarily what the sign says, as a method to regulate where the sign goes.
And again, that's from the U.S. Supreme Court.
Yes. I mean, and this has been not the first time, by the way. This has come up repeatedly, and we get the same message.
There's a very simple solution to that, and just don't allow duplicate signs within 300 feet of each other. It's when you see multiple signs for the same thing, 12 signs for the same thing, it becomes, to the point where it doesn't look right.
I agree. So, I mean, again, if this is one of those issues that you'd like the zoning board to give some special attention to, village attorney, content of signs, please let's note it.
Although I must say, I like Ken's idea of working into it, you know, that temporary signs, you know.
Greater separation.
Yeah, create a separation, whether it's 300 feet or 500 feet or 200 feet.
Right.
I don't care, but I like the idea, Ken.
Okay, to move forward here.
Again, those would be on private property. Mm-hmm. There's no signage allowed within the right of way.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's correct.
Just one other point. We've inserted trellises into the a definition of trellises. We have absolutely no restrictions on what you can do with a trellis. You could have it 20 feet tall. You could have it across the whole length of your property. I don't think there's anything in the, at least as I see it, because basically a trellis is just, you know, a weak fence. Let's call it that. We have all kinds of restrictions on fences. We have nothing on trellises. And I kind of like it. I mean, we had an issue in our subdivision, and you know, but I don't see, you know, that if we're going to have restriction, you know, limitations on fencing, we should have some kind of limitations on trellises.
Well, we do in Chapter 3. There's, I mean, it's probably in many cases, and one, it's the definition to distinguish the issue of trellis versus a fence versus, you know, other. What was the problem that we had in one of the developments?
Correct, and that's what Tom, it's in Tom's subdivision.
12-foot high.
Excuse me. Yeah. But the trellises are in this chapter are separated out by trellises attached to the principal structure and then trellises that are not arbors, pergolas, or trellises that are not attached to the principal structure. I believe that that original separation between those two was to say trellises that are attached to the principal structure can be these fence-like structures, whereas the ones that are not attached would still be handled as fences if they were on the property line. So if they're set back from the property line, they're an accessory structure. If they are on the property line, it would still be considered a fence. But that is my understanding of how it's written here.
Where?
So if you were to look in Chapter 3,
yep.
And then the first reference that I was talking about was the actual table for the permitted uses and structures and required yards.
Page 8 or 9.
And then the fence regulations themselves.
Give me a reference point on that, Rebecca.
I'm sorry. It's on page 8 of Chapter 3, so the general zoning provisions.
Yes.
And then...
give me it by number, because none of the pages are numbered.
Sure. I'm sorry about that. It is 13.3-6.
13.3-6. Okay.
Looks like okay. This, Tom?
Yeah. Okay.
So that's the first part is in the tables where they separate them, trellises attached to principal structures or trellises not attached. It's the first items in that table. So 13.3.6b.
Okay, that would protect us. Let's see. But that would allow a trellis either in the side lot or the rear lot.
Correct. As well. So if it's attached to the principal structure, it could then be an accessory structure in the side yard or the rear yard, but no closer than 5 foot to the property line.
But basically what you're saying is you can do a trellis on the back property line, observing the 5 feet, you can do it the whole length of the property, and without height restriction.
There is no restriction currently that I'm aware of.
That doesn't. If we have all these restrictions for fences, and effectively a trellis is acting as a fence,
right? The trellis would require that it be open by a certain amount, and I'd have to go back to the definitions if that also requires a 50% openness. But it would also require, I think, plant material.
Exactly, but I'm saying is, you know, it would seem like we should have some restrictions with regard to trellises if we're going to have them with regard to fences. It doesn't make any, you know, literally you could do, as long as you observe that 5 feet, you know, you can just about do anything you please, height-wise, length-wise. There's nothing that deals with that.
Well, but if we treat it as a fence-like structure.
Fence-type structures may not privatize the buildable area.
Right.
So I think there are some restrictions.
Fence-like structures are limited to a height of 6 feet.
Correct.
And so we have an imposed height limit. The thing is, and this came up with, what is it, 25 Robin Hood Ranch?
25 Robin Hood Ranch.
Mm-hmm. How do you not make a fence-like structure be not a fence, because one set of rules govern fences, the other are fence or something different. So we need to be able to differentiate.
Right.
You know what? Why don't we put our heads together? Why don't we come up with something? Okay, and let us, so that at our next meeting, that's one of the things that we'll bring to you.
I think it is important, though, that Bob is correct, that he's probably pointed out that we may have restrictions. And I would point out that 25 Robin Hood Ranch went through a variation process for their request.
I'm aware of that, yeah.
So.
But we want to make sure that we're fair moving forward. We don't want to open up the floodgates, because there was a concern raised at the zoning board that this type of approval could create barriers that really weren't anticipated in other places. So
correct.
we need to be very careful.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good point. So give us a chance to sit, and we'll see if we can come up with some additional language.
Okay.
Or clarification of the existing language.
Are we going to make a motion then to continue this at our next plant commission,
let's continue to the next meeting.
Okay.
But the goal should be, if we're capable of putting together some language, and we're also, if you had any other issues that you wanted addressed, we will capture all of that. We'll put it in that final document. The goal will be at your next meeting, I would like us to be able to at least move it on. That should be the goal. So if you have any wordsmithing, Tom, if you have other things, just get that to Rebecca or Gail.
Yeah.
And then we'll figure it out. So
I think we should do include height and the length.
Okay.
Because that's what I hear.
Right.
Okay, because
I'll need to see it again.
We're not moving it now. Have one more meeting. One more meeting.
Not the joint meeting.
All right, because that would give us a lot of time, because we didn't have much time to really look this over.
Because the worst thing I would have happen is I don't want to have it go to the zoning board and have it look like the first thing Champ, Davis, or one of the other zoning board members go, well, it looks like there were too many unresolved issues. I want us to get it as best we can, and then we're going to move it on. It may not be perfect, but it's in reasonably good shape.
The only thing, and Bob, you are away for this short, but an important conversation regarding the very first item regarding bulk and scale. And so maybe if the commissioners want to make a determination as to how they want to forward that language, either with the regulations as they're written or remove them, because that was the...
Right. Because I think, too, we wanted to get the opinion of the attorney as well.
That's fine. I don't want to... I mean, there might be some things that you need that this group cannot reconcile without the input of the attorney. So we could just flag it, move it on, say we need the attorney to weigh in, and the zoning board will need to know that that's something that, you know, it's not fully cooked relative to that issue. But again, there might be many opinions that people have.
Correct. I think there were two differing opinions as to that one item.
But I just keep thinking about when you put it out into the hinterlands of the subdivisions and going, what do you think about this?
Yeah.
It may be totally, we may be getting comments that are far different than what we've heard. So.
All right.
Again, okay. I apologize. I stepped away, and I apologize for that.
No problem. At this juncture, then, I think we are concluding our meeting, and I'd like to have someone make a recommendation that we continue this. I'll make the recommendation that we continue this to the next month's meeting. Is a second?
Second.
And can we just do
voice
all
vote.
In favor?
Yep.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Nay. Okay. The ayes have it.
So, and then just an update for your next meeting. So we'll be talking about this. It's very likely that our park district, they have a master plan that's a special use for their property. They may be wanting to modify that. They received a substantial size grant from the state of Illinois to reorient their baseball fields from four fields down to three. That would impact their lights. It would lessen the impact of the lights on the neighbors. They might add some parking, but all of that has to be done through the amendment to the special use. So that's likely to be before you.
Okay, and then one last comment again, just so everyone understands, if you have any other thoughts, concerns, send them to Rebecca.
Absolutely. Especially spelling errors.
All right, at this juncture, how about a motion for adjournment?
I'll motion that we adjourn the meeting.
Okay, second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Oh, who's aye. That? Thank you.
Thank you.
The meeting is adjourned.